Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave, and we begin a new Acteurist Oeuvre-view this week. Jean Arthur will be talking today about Whirlpool and The Most Precious Thing in Life, two movies from 1934. There will be a fairly lengthy introductory section, though, I think, on Jean Arthur. We'll outline our decision to begin at a fairly late stage in her overall career, if you look at it globally.
And her age. A late stage of her age.
Yeah, we're going to talk about all of that and then dive into the films. Afterwards, we will be having a Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto section, where we talk about two more Kinuyo Tanaka films that we saw at the Lightbox Cinema this week. So, Elise, Jean Arthur. What is the state of your knowledge about Jean Arthur coming into this series?
Seen a lot of her comedies. She is kind of a cult actress. The people who like her really, really like her. Other than that, I just knew a little bit about her nervousness, her neurotic relationship to acting, I guess. I don't know how much of this happened during her screen career. It definitely marred her attempt to have a stage career later, as I reviewed for this episode.
Pretty consistent all the way through. Even at the height of her stardom in the 30s and 40s, she was...
Even when she was making little low-budget westerns, though, when she started out?
That part I don't know about as well. So Jean Arthur was born Gladys Georgianna Greene. That's three G's. She grew up all over the place. She had some New England heritage. She had some Scandinavian heritage. She lived in several parts of the United States. A lot of the time she was living in New England and then in New York City. And she's born in 1900.
That makes her older than most of the actresses associated with this period. Maybe not. How old was Irene Dunne? She was another one who looked younger than she was and rose to stardom a little bit late.
Irene Dunne, I think, was born in the 1890s.
Yeah. There you go. But Betty Davis is 1908, for example.
Right, so 1900, that's around the time that Cagney was born, Gable, Gary Cooper. So the male stars of the 30s, Jean Arthur is a contemporary of theirs. She's a decade older than the Hepburns, Davises, Ginger Rogers, etc.
Irene Dunne, 1898, so very close to Jean Arthur here.
Yeah, so they both got a late start, although Irene Dunne was a star pretty early on, but totally different kind of star, right? She was a singing star first.
Right, and then became a dramatic actress and then became a comedian.
Jean Arthur, her age was definitely a matter of speculation for a long time because it was set further ahead in time. I think when she died, I remember the reports on her death. They cited her year of birth as 1905.
Right.
But that's because, of course, in Hollywood, women definitely have to try to shave years off their lives if they can possibly do it.
Despite the weirdness that we're about to witness in this episode.
Yeah. She had a really long, circuitous route to stardom. She was out on her own in New York City at the end of the 19-teens. She worked as a stenographer. You know, she didn't come from a wealthy background, middle-class background.
The very long Wikipedia entry that seems to be primarily drawn from this biography that you've read.
By John Oler, yeah.
I didn't see anything in it about her ever aspiring to be an actress.
Yeah, it just sort of happened, I think. She drifts into movies. Her first movie is 1923, right? So that's 11 years before the start of our Acteurist Oeuvre-view. Now, if you look at the credits list, so many of those movies from the early to mid-20s, she's uncredited, she's getting a pie thrown at her, stuff like that, right? The same kind of stuff that happened to Carol Lombard, actually.
Well, reading this Wikipedia entry, the overall trajectory seemed to be that she kind of initially failed in Hollywood and then went back to New York and appeared on the stage and didn't have any really big hits or anything, but just built up her resume and I guess learned to act a little better and came back with more clout.
Yeah.
When she returned to Hollywood, and that's when she ends up getting signed to a long-term contract at Columbia, and that's where we're starting here.
Exactly, but let's work our way up. She did have a contract at Paramount from 1928 to 1931. We've actually seen her in a Paramount movie from that time, The Saturday Night Kid, where she plays Clara Bow's pretty reprehensible younger sister.
And the director apparently said he was afraid she was going to steal the picture from Clara Bow. Now, retrospectively, knowing how different that part was and that portrayal was from the Jean Arthur, from the star Jean Arthur, it looked like a very unattractive role. It's hard to understand how she could be stealing pictures from anyone, let alone Clara Bow.
She was pretty good in that movie, but yeah, it's not the kind of part that anyone would hire Jean Arthur for once the Jean Arthur persona solidifies. And then we've also seen her in an RKO film, Silver Horde. Now that, we agreed, she's just not very good in that role. That's from 1930, kind of spoiled socialite who acts like a jerk with Joel McRae.
But there's also, it's also like almost not even a role though.
No, it's a terrible role.
At least it's a meaty part in Saturday Night Kid.
Exactly. And I've seen her in a few other things from that period too, right? She's in the Canary murder case, you know, a suspect in Philo Vance movies. She's a real basic ingenue in different things. That's pretty much all Paramount thought to do with her. Paramount just has a pretty bad track record with a lot of the stars that they had under contract. Either they miscast them or they just totally buried them in second leads and never really took the trouble to find a vehicle for them. They just had too many people. And the only way you got out of that is if you had an auteur on staff who wanted to do something with you, right? Like obviously Sternberg and Dietrich, there was no problem. Janet McDonald and Lubitsch, clearly she was getting great parts that suited her to a T. But most of the other women under contract at Paramount, probably the best of them was Claudette Colbert, but even she wasn't getting roles that make sense for the Claudette Colbert we come to know, but they're fun roles, I guess, like Cleopatra. And none of that was working for Jean Arthur. She wanted out. She wanted, and she hated her own performances. She was very self-critical. It wasn't just nervousness. It was that she didn't think she was very good. And she never really came around to thinking she was very good. Although at first I think she was right, because critics are pretty unanimously nasty to her in her 20s performances. So nobody thought she was doing a good job, including her.
For some reason, she kept going despite this.
She's tenacious. And yeah, she goes back to New York. She does star in plays, right? Not huge success plays, but plays that ran for a couple of months. Agents saw her.
And she does start getting good notices now.
Exactly. And Harry Cohn at Columbia is assembling the rudiments of a real studio, finally. Now, one of the reasons that Jean Arthur came up immediately as someone, or pretty close to the beginning of our actorist odyssey here, as someone that we could do, is because she was a Columbia star. And we're not doing Columbia as part of the Hollywood studios year by year. Now, why is that? It's because Columbia took a while to get rolling, and they never had their own chain of theaters, so they were kind of in the same boat as Universal, but they didn't have Universal City, right? They had a real small-time operation. They made fewer movies per year than the majors and even the major minors, until you get to the 40s and 50s, when they pretty much move up to the front rank. But in the 30s, you know, in the early 30s, all they have is Frank Capra. And even there, Frank Capra is not generating immense profits until you get to It Happened One Night. And of course, It Happened One Night changed the industry in general. It made romantic comedy, screwball comedy, the genre, and the genre that women could make a name for themselves in.
Well, this turns out to be a very fortuitous meeting that she ends up signing to Columbia, for both herself in meeting Frank Capra, and for Frank Capra, for that matter, because who knows? I mean, obviously he'd already had that immense success with It Happened One Night, but she's very strongly associated with the Capra films.
Right. Well, Capra had had, in the early 30s, he had his association with Barbara Stanwyck.
Yep.
That was the auteur-actor combo at Columbia, but she moved on. He was going to need someone else to fill that very important role. And Jean Arthur just fit exactly with the new Capra that emerges in the second half of the 30s.
And Dave, this is something that is probably in that biography, but maybe you didn't recall, or maybe you did. But apparently it was her role in Whirlpool that brought her to Capra's attention, that he just happened to see the daily rushes.
Yeah.
So this female reporter role, although it's immensely different in Mr. Deeds and much better, nevertheless, I guess he got his idea from this movie.
Yeah. So that's why we're beginning in 1934 with the Columbia Films. And we're going to go from here. Now, not all of Jean Arthur's great movies are at Columbia. She will be on loan out, particularly for Easy Living. That's at Paramount. But in general, yeah, the fact that she was at Columbia makes a huge difference, and it has a huge impact on the genres that she will appear in and the success that she'll eventually have.
So, Dave, why is Jean Arthur so special to you?
That's something I think we're going to have to take the whole series to develop. And obviously, I can't make any claims about Whirlpool or The Most Precious Thing in Life, because this is the first time I'm seeing them. I looked at my Leonard Maltin TV and movie guide from 1991, and they're not in it. And that's pretty rare, actually. For most movies of this time, if they ever showed on TV even once, they get into that guide.
It's more, the copies we saw are in very good shape.
Yeah, so there's been a restoration. They're in much better shape than, for instance, the movie we watched last week for Paramount 1940, The Way of All Flesh. Columbia has done well by a lot of their back product. We're the beneficiaries of that. I don't think we're going to see a lot of lousy copies of films in this series. But once you get to her Capra films, obviously I grew up as a big Capra fan. I loved her from those movies. I am also a fan of Borzage and one of his best films, History is Made at Night. Great role for Jean Arthur. Easy Living is easily one of my very favorite films. That's coming up. Those George Stevens movies. More the Merrier is an amazing movie for her. Talk of the Town, we actually had a discussion on our Discord about this. A beloved film, but her role is not as great as you'd hope in that one. All of these things we're going to get to and talk about in detail. I guess the thing that people always talk about with Jean Arthur is the distinct quality of her voice.
The main reason, weirdly enough, that I never became a huge Jean Arthur fan when I first started really getting into movies is because Margaret Sullavan had made such a huge impact on me with The Shop Around the Corner. I just didn't have room in my heart for another funny-voiced, bobbed-haired waif.
So it's a Sullavan versus Arthur battle in your mind.
I mean, those are the only similarities between them, that they are a little bit funny-looking and waifish and have very distinct voices. Of course, every actress of this period has a very distinct voice, but somehow their voices stand out even among the Davises and the Hepburns and the so on and so forth.
Right. Well, I don't think her voice is as distinctive as Hepburn, let's say, but it's distinctively...
Well, it's enchanting, and exactly. That is similar to Margaret Sullavan, how people reacted to her voice.
Right. I think that is the difference.
Doesn't really have it yet, though.
We definitely saw it, although it certainly will develop.
Very much so, as she becomes more of a comedian.
Right. Other qualities that we associate with Jean Arthur, she's one of the people that is most associated with the screwball comedy, and of course that's because she was the in-house Columbia star, and Columbia was the house of screwball comedy.
Right, and then everybody else copied Capra, basically, in their own way.
Yeah, and of course some people, you know, a lot of people came on loan out to Columbia to get their baptism in the screwball genre, of course beginning with Claudette Colbert, but also Carol Lombard. It's debatable whether 20th Century is the same kind of screwball comedy that It Happened One Night is, but at the time they were both seen as part of some kind of Columbia comedy vanguard. Irene Dunne will show up to do Theodora Goes Wild, which totally reinvents her career, and so on and so on. Really was a studio that made very few movies in the grand scheme of things, but so many of the hit screwball comedies came out of Columbia. What do you associate with Jean Arthur? Plain speaking, she represents the average American point of view.
In the roles I've seen her in, there's a dichotomy between strength and delicacy that's similar to Sullavan, but as we've talked about, Sullavan rarely does represent the average American point of view in her movies. She's definitely more of a elitist flavor.
Right. And Sullivan, I think you're right. Like, they probably are the two most comparable stars to each other, even though they're completely unique. But they have such vast differences between them. And a lot of it comes in the relative proportions of strength and fragility that they show. They both have both qualities. But, of course, Sullivan dies all the time in her movies, and Jean Arthur never does, right? Jean Arthur, even though behind the scenes she was actually physically ill pretty much the whole time she was on movie sets, she never comes across that way. She always gives you the sense of real strength, but not the kind of strength that you see in a Hepburn, right?
Or a Davis.
Exactly. It's soft-spoken, but very stubborn.
Well, she's very feminine, and yet she plays these tough reporters for Capra, these tough and cynical reporters. And we mentioned, oh, we should say now, we're not doing The Plainsman again.
No.
We decided we weren't going to suffer through that again. We did note, watching it, that she is one of the most convincingly tomboyish actresses, that she really does have an androgynous quality, despite her femininity, quality of not caring about that.
Oh, well, yeah. And of course, after her film career, she becomes associated with the role of Peter Pan.
So she's got a bit of strange androgyny that's elusive in a way that a lot of these waifish actresses have, even Sullivan has in my mind a bit.
Yeah, although Jean Arthur, it's much more important to her. I mean, gender critique is everything to her at a certain point.
And she apparently derived her stage name.
Oh, yes.
Or screen name, or whatever you want to call it, from Joan of Arc and King Arthur.
Yeah, well, that was mentioned in her obituary. That's always been part of the saga, yes.
So I always do find this fascinating, like a very feminine actress who nevertheless perceives herself as very androgynous, and yeah, who that's important to. And I mean, in a way, that's true of Hepburn as well, but to a totally different effect.
She definitely appears to have been queer.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Oh, the Oeuvre book is really interesting. I haven't read it in 15 years, like, or more. I reread a little bit today, but I didn't read the whole thing. I mean, Jean Arthur and any other human being, it was difficult for her. But she does appear to have had at least some kind of long-term off-and-on relationship with Mary Martin.
Okay, who also played Peter Pan.
Yes, they're Peter Pan's together. That's a big part of the story that you have to think about behind the scenes, right? But ultimately, I'm not sure she would have made the people she was attracted to the most important aspect of her personality if you asked her, because she kind of liked just being alone with her hundreds of animals.
So we've seen some similar types in our Acteurist Oeuvre-view, perhaps most notably Setsuko Hara.
Exactly. I think she's probably more comparable to Setsuko Hara than anyone else that we've talked about.
Like Setsuko Hara, and to a lesser extent, Daniel Day-Lewis, maybe. I mean, she made many, many more films than Daniel Day-Lewis, but she retired very early, turned to a stage career, and then the stage career was kind of botched by her neurosis, as I already mentioned.
She retired early in terms of, like, she was still a star when she decided to kind of step back. However, of course, you have to remember that she was, you know, just about 50 when she did step back, which is pretty old for an actress of that time to stop starring in films. So it's kind of too early and late in a way.
Well, some people just kept going.
She did stay in the public eye. She's not like Setsuko Hara, who disappeared completely. You know, she had TV specials later on and stuff. So she kept getting lured back in different ways. But yeah, she didn't stay on a la Hepburn and continue to star in weird vehicles into the 1980s. Career clearly could have gone on longer if she had wanted it to, because there was not any let up in terms of the public's interest in her, I don't think. It's just that it was getting too hard. She clearly had some wish to return before the public eye occasionally, even though she was ridiculously non-compliant with the Hollywood star-making machine.
It does seem that in her stage career, she did a lot of arguing.
Yeah.
With directors, which is, again, a Margaret Sullivan quality.
Despite the fact, like, she was clearly deeply neurotic, but I don't think anyone was ever afraid she was going to kill herself. So there's a difference between Sullivan and Arthur, but a lot of the same impact on the career, anyway.
What Wikipedia has to say is that she retired when her contract with Columbia Pictures expired in 1944. So this is only...
But she does come back.
10 years later, so she's only in her mid-40s at this point. And the only thing she came back for after that was Billy Wilder's A Foreign Affair and the Western Shane.
Right, with George Stevens.
And that's after that is when she started doing more theater. So her big Broadway triumph was Peter Pan. Leonard Bernstein's adaptation of Peter Pan in 1950, and then she tried to play Joan of Arc in a 1954 production of Saint Joan, but had a nervous breakdown after battling with the director, and then went into retirement for 11 years. But then, yes, she comes back to TV. So yeah, so there's a little pattern of going away and coming back here.
Yeah, so she likes it. You know, it's not like Setsuko Hara, who I think really did hate it and wanted nothing more to do with anyone. When she left, that was it. Nobody ever saw her again. So Jean Arthur does keep coming back, but then she's annoyed by having to deal with people and she leaves again. And she goes back to her animals. And she lived until 1991. So she lived a long life, and it sounds quite pleasant to me, living with all those cats and dogs and other creatures in a nice bucolic setting. If she kept coming back, she must have wanted something out of those TV appearances or stage appearances that she just wasn't able to enact at a certain point. So.
Well, we still remember poor Clara Bow retiring to that
ranch,
and then not even maintaining that marriage, but just acting Shakespeare into dictaphones for the rest of her life.
Yeah, obviously this is not nearly as sad as Clara Bow's.
That case too, there was still some desire to be creative.
Yeah, of course.
But not able to handle, well, the fame was Clara Bow's problem.
Right. Yeah, I don't think that was the problem for Jean Arthur, and she just didn't let it be a problem, right? Like I was saying before, she did not sign autographs, she did not go on any studio junkets.
She didn't give interviews, apparently.
She did not take any photos for publicity for films. She did not do anything.
But we see all these photos of her that are Hollywood glamour shots.
But obviously they were just taken while she was on the set, because she didn't make any effort to go outside of the regular shooting schedule to do anything, apparently. And she managed to keep working at Columbia.
Yeah, that's very, very odd that an actress would even be allowed to do that. This is something I didn't know. After she rises to stardom in Mr. Deeds Goes to Town, in 1936 alone, she earned $119,000, more than the President of the United States and baseball star Lou Gehrig combined. She was a huge star. So
she was.
Nobody, like, people tried to tell Hepburn and Betty Davis what to do. Apparently nobody was going to tell Jean Arthur what to do.
Well, again, this is the special quality of Columbia, because it had one big star, it's Jean Arthur. It had one big director, that's Frank Capra, and these people did what they wanted, because Harry Cohn was like, if you succeed, good. You're here, I want you, I will pay you. It's a real paradox, because obviously Harry Cohn's reputation, every single mogul, everyone involved in being a film executive during that time was exploiting the talent that worked for them, and almost all of them were exploiting the talent sexually as well. And even in that environment, which is like Me Too times 1,000, Harry Cohn stood out as the grossest of the moguls. He was notorious for pulling this awful stuff on starlets. However, as a company, Columbia really put women in the driver's seat in a lot of the films. And that would continue, right? Columbia is the studio of Rita Hayworth. It's the studio of Kim Novak, even into the 50s, making movies around women for the most part. And that's Harry Cohn's model.
So whatever her queerness entailed, she was married to a man from 1932 to 1949.
Yeah, I don't think they really spent much time together.
Well, yeah, could have been one of those. Was there ever any hint of anything going on with Capra?
Forget. Obviously, we know that Capra and Stanwyck were involved.
And he was married, and that's why that ended.
Exactly. I wish I remembered more of the book, but I will make sure to reread those sections when we get to the Capra movies. Now, we're not doing Mr. Deeds again, because we have already discussed it, but we will bring it up when its place in the sequence comes up. And we'll also bring up The Plainsman, because as much as we don't want to talk about the nuts and bolts of that movie, it's an important performance.
Well, she said that was her favorite film role, it says here. So, I mean, obviously it had a place in her heart like Peter Pan.
Yeah, and it's an interesting role. It's just that the movie is a mess,
yeah,
as we discussed.
Her role becomes a mess too.
Quite an iconic figure at the beginning of that film, and then it just gets all derailed by just terrible choices, terrible narrative choices by Cecil B. DeMille and his screenwriter. Why do I love Jean Arthur? Probably if you try to sum it up, not that easy. But if you're becoming a film fan as a teenager, you're watching all these movies. You know, if I try to zero in on why she became probably my favorite actress, it was always either Jean Arthur Arthur or Barbara Stanwyck. So I'm just like Frank Capra, clearly. Jean Arthur, her movies, the roles that she took, and the way she plays them, for the most part, you can completely empathize with her. She never felt like someone who's foreign to me. She felt like someone confronted with a world that is just too much to handle most of the time. And so you feel like, okay, she gets it. She understands the problem of the human being in our society. However, she also always seems to be able to navigate that in a way that everyone hopes that they can. And she has a position of knowledge in most of those films that everyone kind of wishes they had. She understands the plots of the movies that she appears in better than anyone else in the movies that she appears in.
The Rosalind effect, she'd probably like to play that role that Hepburn eventually got to play on stage.
I think that's what it is. You know, ultimately, she just seems like the ideal co-conspirator between viewer, the storytellers behind the scenes. She is the person that's the intermediary there. And we all are trying to figure this out. And she is this way into a strategy for surviving this world.
I'm talking about Shakespeare's Rosalind. You triggered me thinking about it that way. She's kind of the archetype of the English language anyway, female comedy character, but it's also an androgynous role. And Harold Bloom specifically talks about her in that way, as having this position of total knowledge.
Yeah, and we see that right from these first two movies, which we'll be talking about. I didn't expect it to be there, but it is.
We will be seeing that role played by Elizabeth Bergner, an actress who I've never seen in a performance, only read about, but reading about her, she has many of these Jean Arthur qualities, but times about 1,000, at least in her private life and her reputation as an actress, so we'll see about that.
We're going to be doing an Elizabeth Bergner Actorist Spotlight in the future. Not too soon, but in the 2020s.
I'm really eager about that one, though, because she's kind of my archetype of an ideal actress, Elizabeth Bergner, but I've never seen her actually give a performance, so we'll see how this goes. My expectations might be a bit high.
Well, we'll see. I know, I'm interested too. I think it's probably almost time to get into the films, but people who listen to our Hollywood Studios Year by Year feature know that we go into Joel W. Findler's The Hollywood Story and look at his charts of each of the big studios. Well, Joel Findler is not like Ethan Mordden, who left Columbia out of his book. He has Columbia in the book. He's got his chart for Columbia, and I thought that's a good place for us to start, since we're really looking at the Jean Arthur at Columbia and what was going on, what that studio did for her, what she did for it. So if you're not familiar with Findler's book, he lists all of the big contract stars and players at the major studios, and he gives them 3 stars, 2 stars, or 1 star, and in a few instances, no stars. And that's all based on what he perceives to be their value to the studio during the length of their tenure. So at the beginning of the 1930s, Columbia has Ralph Graves, 2 stars.
Don't even know who that is.
He leaves in 1932. Well, he's in Ladies of Leisure. He's the artist guy in Ladies of Leisure. It has Jack Holt, 2 stars. And of course, Jack Holt was the star of Whirlpool, so we'll be meeting him shortly. It has Barbara Stanwyck from 1929 to 1932, and she gets 3 stars, but she's gone by 1934. And it has Buck Jones, who's a Western star, 1 star. Jean Arthur is the 5th person on the list. She's the 5th person ever deserving of any kind of mention on the charts for Columbia, according to Findler, and she, of course, gets 3 stars. And in 1934, they also acquire Grace Moore, 1 star.
That's my grandmother's name. She just passed away at the age of 94 and a half.
Yes, very sad events this week. And this Grace Moore, do you know her?
Opera singer, isn't she?
Exactly.
Not well. No, I think I have seen a movie of hers or two.
Yeah, she appears in a few movies in the middle of the 1930s. And Ralph Bellamy is on the list here. He gets 1 star and probably doesn't deserve more than that, although I really enjoy Ralph Bellamy. He's not going to make any kind of a splash when you list him at the top of your cast. So that's the context. In 1934, the only stars they have are Jack Holt, this Buck Jones guy, and Jean Arthur, and Grace Moore and Ralph Bellamy coming on as 1 star minor players. So Jean Arthur is really Cohn's hope for a homegrown star and not have to keep borrowing everybody, right? The way they've been doing. Capra in 1934, of course, made It Happened One Night with Colbert, and the other movie he made that year is Broadway Bill, and they had to borrow Myrna Loy for that. So the idea here is, let's cast internally. Let's have someone that can actually play these Capra roles in-house, now that Stanwyck's gone. As a lead-in to our talk about Whirlpool, I just want to read read what John Oler has to say about the beginning of her tenure at Columbia. So this is on page 77 of the book. So he's taken his time to describe the early struggles of Jean Arthur and her inability to get much traction in the silent era and the early sound era, and her return to New York and her decision to sign with Columbia. And here we get, I guess this was at the back of my mind when I decided we should start in 1934. Indeed, it was evident that this Jean Arthur was a completely different person from the one who had left Hollywood only 3 years before. Now nearly bleach blonde, there was a confidence and a piquancy to her manner that was entirely missing in all previous film appearances. Her new image was best displayed in a scene in which she jauntily bounces into breakfast with her mother and stepfather after being out nearly all night with Holt. The judge asks her in a scolding tone, "Don't you think that coming home at 4 a.m. requires some kind of explanation?" To which she responds saucily, "4 a.m. should never be explained, my dear." When the judge follows up by asking whether she would mind telling him and her mother who she was with, she quickly retorts with obvious enjoyment, "The witness refuses to answer, Your Honor." This was the first scene in the movies that allowed Arthur to engage in genuine repartee. Whirlpool was also the first film in which Arthur played a traditionally masculine role, here a big city newspaper reporter. She appears relaxed and confident, almost brash at times. While critics have tended to overlook Whirlpool in tracing Arthur's metamorphosis as a film actress, it remains the earliest film in which one can recognize the Jean Arthur of the classic movies of later years.
Like her Marked Woman or something for Betty Davis?
I think so, although of course Betty Davis had some good roles before that. It did signal a major change. But it's more dramatic here. There's just nothing in Jean Arthur's previous 11 years worth of films.
Well, that's why she had to go away and come back.
So, without further ado, let us begin with Whirlpool, Elise.
Again, we talked about how gross Harry Cohn was with starlets. Maybe the most gross of all the studio bosses, which was saying something.
Yep.
Seems to have been an okay place for female screenwriters.
Sure, and female producers eventually, as we know.
So here we've got two female screenwriters. Oh yeah, right, Virginia Van Upp. Two female screenwriters, Dorothy Howell, who started out as Cohn's secretary and was appointed assistant general production manager in 1926, and Ethel Hill, who is also a writer on The Most Precious Thing in Life, and Dorry Sherry was apprenticed to Ethel Hill when he got started as a screenwriter at Columbia.
Cool.
Little tiny Wikipedia entry on Ethel Hill. The only other thing we learn is that she was an extremely dear and generous woman who had an interest in horses and often wore jodhpurs and riding gear to the studio. So I say lesbian. Fellow screenwriter Gertrude Walker, who worked with Hill toward the end of her career at Republic Pictures, described her as a sweet old lady who always wore a shawl and bedroom slippers. I don't know, that's giving less lesbian vibes, but...
it's granny vibes.
Granny vibes. Of these two directors, I know nothing.
So Roy William Neal is a known quantity to me. He directed a lot of the Sherlock Holmes movies in the 40s, the Basil Rathbone movies. He also directed an amazing noir, Black Angel, with Dan Duryea. You remember that one?
Not particularly, no.
He's a piano player, and there's an amnesia aspect to it. Anyway, it's a really interesting movie. We will be doing it again at some point. He is a really good technical director, and Whirlpool is very snappy.
Sure.
Obviously, no one's ever made a claim for him as an auteur, and I don't see any basis for that. He just directed whatever, but he does a good job. I thought this was a really good movie.
So it's notable that the two movies are sort of the same story and inverted. An absent father reunited with adult daughter and adult son and absent mother, Most Precious Thing in Life. Jean Arthur plays the daughter in one and then turns around and plays the mother in the other.
To show her versatility right off the bat.
Look at the ring. She's practically Daniel Day-Lewis.
She's almost never actually playing the age that she was in these movies. She's either playing a young girl or she's playing a late middle-aged woman.
And I mean, she looks 35 once you know she's 35, but she also has this girlish ingenue quality about her, right?
Yeah, which she basically has all the way through up until the 50s.
Well, and this is why she's playing Peter Pan, I guess. Distinct youthfulness. These plots just made me wonder, what is Columbia doing? Like, what are these movies? Who are these made for? They're not romances. They're sentimental melodramas, but on a low budget. What were they doing?
Well, we'll tackle them one at a time, because I think there's, even though there are very strong similarities, which you're right to point out, they're two very different feeling films.
So Jack Holt, who's very good in Whirlpool, he played this kind of role a lot, apparently.
He was a Western star, and also, yeah, he could play this kind of
gangster with a heart of gold. Another notable similarity between the two films is that they are very, very anti-establishment.
Yeah, as Harry Cohn certainly allowed his films to be, at the very least. And maybe he felt that way, right? He was an outsider. The other studios treated him like garbage. You got here last, so you're a loser. And he was always dealing with that, right up until Columbia just became a fact that could no longer be ignored. But that scrappy outsider aspect of Columbia is what empowered Capra, certainly, to do his name above the title stuff. And it's pretty much always there. So, yeah, the political inflections in these films are quite interesting, I think.
Yeah.
We start at a carnival. Both movies start in, like, 1909. 1910 as well. They're both taking place over the same span of time, the exact same span of years. It's fascinating.
Well, they do share the one screenwriter, Ethel Hill.
Exactly. So she really liked 1909 to 1934. She just loved thinking about that period in American history. And it is an interesting period. There's a lot of changes that occur, right? So this carnival, they barnstorm across the Midwest, fleecing the hicks and rubes that they encounter. Jack Holt owns the carnival. He has little to do, it seems like, with the day-to-day operations of the various cons and attractions. He leaves a lot of that to his right-hand man, Alan Jenkins, borrowed from Warner Brothers.
Who's also his male marriage partner, basically, and also doing the comic relief.
I mean, Alan Jenkins, totally unique performer. We've seen him in a few instances already in Warner Brothers movies in I Am a Fugitive from a Chain Gang. He is Paul Muni's pal that puts him up for a night in Atlanta. Well, I don't think they call it Atlanta, but it's Atlanta. They brought him over, so they spared no expense to create real gangster atmosphere here. But they're not gangsters at the beginning, right? They are small-time con men.
Oh, they never act like gangsters, really. There's no gangstering happening in this movie. It's a sentimental melodrama.
They are involved in the underworld by the end.
They are, but we don't, like, there aren't shootout scenes or big nightclub scenes or anything like that.
No, not exactly. No, it's true. Jack Holt, though, he's a womanizer. Always got some new lady in every town they stop off in, and that's more what he does while his employees fleece the rubes. But now he has met a woman that he has fallen in love with, for real.
This actress had a very interesting face. I guess it was Lila Lee? Helen Rankin Morrison?
Yeah.
Yeah, I loved her face. It was amazing.
I feel like I've seen her before, but I don't remember where, actually.
She was a silent actress, but yeah, she kept going into the late 30s.
Yeah, she was really good.
She's actually younger than Jean Arthur, born 1905.
They're not ever on screen at the same time in their actual...
No, she's got old lady makeup on.
She's made up by the time they're playing mother and daughter.
Yes.
This scene, when we were watching it at the beginning, I was like, well, what is this? Is he a con man? Does he do this every city he goes to? The movie leaves that ambiguous, but then you begin to realize that, oh, wait a minute, he really does love her.
Well, to me, it looked like the plot we were maybe being set up for was what they discuss, which is that he's just going to get bored of this marriage, even though he really loves her.
Right. No, in fact,
completely different plot.
This guy, he really has made a decision. He really does think she's different. He is in love with her, but unfortunately, right at the beginning of their marriage, they've had time to consummate it, at the very least. He goes back to check on the carnival, which he's going to sell. He's making this clean breast of things. Before he can do that, the cops have shown up and they don't take kindly to carnivals molesting their citizens, and a big fight breaks out.
Well, yeah, it's made clear in this scene and in the courtroom scene that he's being persecuted because he's a carny, so the outsider.
Yeah, exactly. Now, he does kill someone in this brawl, but he didn't instigate it.
Well, he seems to think it was self-defense.
Well, it seemed like it was, yeah. And he doesn't try to kill the guy. He just happens to hit his head on a pipe, which is real bad
but
luck.
He gets a maximum 20 years, the judge says, because he was a carnival owner.
Exactly. And that's the kind of discretion judges have, sadly. That's the end of that marriage, basically. Now, that's not how she sees it. She wants things to continue. She wants to stay in correspondence with him.
And also, she's pregnant.
Right. Well, she reveals that to him when she meets him at the prison. He's already made several pleas to her to forget about him, move on with her life. 20 years is a lifetime.
There's all these shots of each of them behind the grid, the screen that they have to talk to during visits, with their eyes shining with tears as she explains to him that she's pregnant.
Yeah, it's very moving, I find. Unexpectedly so. I thought these would all be perfunctory, right? I didn't know Jack Holt at all, but he really impressed me.
Yeah, he's good. He was definitely good in this. He definitely had a knack for this particular type of character.
So we find out how this prison works. It's on an island, it seems like, and there's a whirlpool eddying around it. You can't escape. If you dive into the water, you just get sucked down and die. And he talks this over with Ward Bond, his cellmate. Ward Bond appears in both of these films. I guess if you get to a certain point, you just don't care anymore. You want a jailbreak, and you'd rather just commit suicide by whirlpool than spend one more day in their lousy jail.
This isn't Jack Holt's problem, though. He's not suicidal.
No, he's prepared to wait it out. But what he's not prepared for is to have his wife wait out the best years of her life so that she can rejoin him once they're decrepit. He's a respected man around the prison, doing a clerical job, he says, and this gives him an opening to send out a letter of condolence explaining that poor Jack Holt is dead. He jumped into a whirlpool and expired, and no body will ever be found, but he's not coming back. He's gone. I guess that's how things worked in those days. No further inquiries were made. She never contacts the prison again to see if she could get his personal effects or anything. I guess he has no personal effects. He's in prison. So I suppose it all makes sense that she never questions it. She got an official letterhead statement that he's dead. And so he accomplishes his mission.
There's no body. So that's right. What's she gonna do?
There's no funeral. That's it. Then we get a montage and we see all of the years that passed by, all of the big events. World War I, obviously, the Roaring Twenties, the Great Depression, the onset of it anyway, because he's released in 1929. And his faithful friend, Alan Jenkins, is there to pick him up.
Yeah, despite the fact that they got divorced, now they're together again.
That's right. And Alan Jenkins, his shtick is that he's always sick. He's always got some malady he's complaining about when he's a young man and when he's an old man. And also, he thinks women are the bunk.
Right. But he's, you know, calm about that.
Oh, yeah. Well, he's not openly antagonistic to any actual women.
Well, actually, he is towards one woman who... This is a pretty hilarious performance.
Yeah, I really liked her, too. But she is someone that you'd have to fight with.
Yeah, she's pretty awful. They don't actually allow him to boot her in the ass, though. There's a failed attempt at that. Who was this woman? Rita LeRoy. Have you seen her in anything else, ever?
I don't know. I didn't recognize her. I'm sure she is in other movies. Probably some that I've seen. But this was a distinctive performance, that's for sure.
She's also hilarious in Blonde Venus as Taxi Bell Hooper. Now a memorable small role. She's a complete asshole in that movie too, but it's fantastic, her delivery. Yeah. And she's pretty funny in this.
She shows up a little later on, right? Because as Jack Holt and Alan Jenkins drive off in their rickety car, Holt tells him, "We've been small-time grifters for way too long. It's time to enter the big time." So that's kind of a statement of intent. The movie shows us that he knows what he's talking about. He's learned enough in prison that he is able to move into big time gangster circles gambler circles.
It seemed to me that this screenplay accomplished in two lines of dialogue what it would take a whole Warner Brothers movie to represent, which is the idea that they made me a criminal, basically.
Yeah, exactly. But it's there, right? He is now thoroughly embedded in the underworld, and we see him, he's a respected man in that milieu. He owes favors to even more powerful gangsters, and that's going to generate most of the rest of the plot of the film. But yeah, it really moves quickly to bring us to 1934. They own a nightclub. You know, they're basically just like any other gangster that you see, although there's, as you say, no gunplay. Well, not until the end. Different kind of gunplay than you normally get. He's got his mob around him.
No, they're the guys from Touche Pas au Crosby.
Yeah, exactly. Except that there is this real romance.
Failed and fatal.
Right, but he is still carrying a torch for his wife. He just can't allow her to even know about him because it would wreck her life.
He does get some on the side, so that's where Rita LeRoy comes in.
She certainly doesn't feel very secure because she knows he doesn't have any feelings for her.
But she did find out his real name, so there must have been a real relationship at some point.
Yeah, I guess there was a heart-to-heart at some point. You're right.
It seems impossible to believe at the time at which we see them.
Yeah, they've fallen far from whatever heights they achieved in terms of mutual understanding. What's going on right now? Hotshot mobster in New York who's going on trial. The only way to get him off from the murder charges is for Jack Holt to testify and give an alibi. And this is all arranged. It's all set up. Everyone knows it's coming. And you've got beat reporters who have identified this. Defense lawyers are making no secret of it. They're saying, we are bringing this star witness who is going to provide all the evidence that you need to know. Holt is committed to this. He's going to do it. Alan Jenkins doesn't like the idea. He doesn't even want to fly there at all.
The movie has no judgment towards gangsters whatsoever.
No. Look, they have to do something. It wasn't judgmental about them being carnies, and it's not judgmental about them doing whatever they're doing now. You just have to get along in this life. And if you're a nice guy, the movie loves you. Now we finally make it to a newspaper office where the assignment goes to Jean Arthur.
She's stuck on zoo stories, which is actually sort of reminiscent of, it's interesting, her personal animal love is by coincidence or design written into the story, like Shirley MacLaine and New Age twaddle in Artists and Models.
Yeah, it could be. It could be.
She's on the zoo beat, and the movie makes it clear that that's as far as she's going to be allowed to go in this newspaper office.
It's a totally sexist environment.
Unless she does have this opportunity to move up if she uses her feminine charms to get the goods on this gangster.
Yeah, so that's the double-edged sword of patriarchy, right? It sticks you in a totally innocuous place until they need your legs. And then if you're willing to use them and you get the big story, well, maybe you can get a little promotion, but you'll still always be thought of now as a problem for a different reason because you traded on your sexual wiles. It really sucks to be a woman in 1934.
She's got this absolute loser of a suitor, but she's really in love with him.
Donald Cook. This guy played a pill over and over again. He's Cagney's straight arrow brother in The Public Enemy. He's in Babyface as one of the people she steps on.
Well, he is totally useless in this movie, but he's just a plot device, basically.
Yeah, exactly. So that's all Columbia had on hand for this kind of thing. I don't know if he was under contract in a minor way to them, because I've seen him at other studios, but whatever, they borrowed him twice for these two movies. He's in both movies.
You know what's crazy? Apparently he was well known for his stage role as David in Claudia. Was he then playing opposite Dorothy McGuire on stage?
I would say so.
Let's see. The show starred Dorothy McGuire and Donald Cook as David Naughton, so clearly he was capable of more than these films are demanding of him. He does not look like a romantic leading man, though.
No, he's got a bit too much of a hatchet face.
That was a huge hit, that play. That's why Dorothy McGuire ended up being signed by Selznick.
Yeah, and obviously he kept working in Hollywood. He was a professional. He did what was asked of him, and he was often just asked to play this kind of non-entity suitor.
Although definitely Dorothy McGuire was cited as the reason for the place.
Sure. I don't think he has the charm of Robert Young, and that's what was needed.
Certainly
for the film.
Not in film. He does not. Then these two must meet.
Exactly. So she is very good at her job, though. You know, she insinuates herself into the club. Now, no one's seen him, right? And that's a big part of the saga here, that he has managed to rise in criminal circles without being photographed. So she's kind of caught flat-footed. She's trying to pretend like she's a good personal friend of Jack Holt, but she doesn't notice him when he walks right by, or she certainly doesn't know that it's Duke.
Well, she recognizes him for a different reason.
Exactly. She does a double take when she sees him because, of course, the photo, there's one photo of him. It's been established from the beginning of the film. He gave it to his bride-to-be way back during the carny days. And she's grown up looking at this photo. This is Dad. Long dead Dad. But he's alive. How can it be? Despite the fact that she's found out and it's revealed that she doesn't know him, she still gets into his office and spots a typewriter, jumps on it, and does a perfect stenographer routine. So she takes the letter, shows it to him, gets his signature on it.
So from that moment on, this, as soon as she reveals that she knows who he is, the central relationship of the movie is this, it's basically portrayed as a romance between the father and the daughter.
The family romance.
Yes, they act like lovers.
Yeah, pretty much.
And everyone thinks they're lovers.
Donald Cook gets pretty pretty burned up when he finds out about it.
Is also the case, although for reasons we'll discuss, less sexy. Like, Jack Holt actually seems like he would make a better leading man for Jean Arthur than Donald Cook.
Well, of course. Of course. Right. And he is the leading man of this film.
So yeah, definitely it's less sexy, but still just as romantic and the most precious thing in life.
Yeah. So yeah, they have a really good chemistry together, I think.
She gets to emote a lot.
She does. And again, this is just not the kind of thing that she was given a chance to do in earlier films. Here, I mean, it really is a nice embryonic picture of all the different things Jean Arthur is going to do.
Well, I mean, as we're saying this, it occurs to me for the first time, it's not so much different than her relationship with Mr. Deeds, which has this curious asexual quality.
It's a notable fact. Mr. Smith as well. I mean, it gets a little bit more romantic near the end, but mostly she thinks of him as a little boy heading off to school.
And Mr. Deeds is kind of like a boy and a dad at the same time.
Right. Devil and Miss Jones, another amazing movie for her.
She gets to be very sexy in The More the Merrier.
Well,
though.
That's what I was building
and
up
and
to.
Stevens does that with lots of actresses who aren't considered conventionally sexy.
Exactly. That's always cited as maybe the hottest scene in classic Hollywood history. Yeah. The scene with Joel McRae on the steps, right?
So she can do it.
She can do it. An even bigger contrast, because a lot of the movies around it, she's paired up either with dad or man children. And in Devil and Miss Jones, the real relationship that the movie cares about is her relationship with Charles Coburn. I mean, she's got a boyfriend, Robert Cummings, and he's good too, but it's really about how is she going to relate to this weirdo business owner who goes undercover at their department store.
And even in Easy Living, her biggest chemistry is with
Edward Arnold,
yeah.
Yes, but I guess she has some pretty good scenes with Ray Milland too.
No, I just mean as an actress. Yeah, they're great together being wacky, but I feel like there's more actual relationship, emotional relationship happening with Edward Arnold.
Yeah. There's so many good movies to talk about here. But yeah, very few of them are like super hot sexual chemistry movies, with the exception of The More the Merrier, I think. We'll see. We'll be on the lookout for it if we see other movies that have it. But yeah, for the most part, that's not what you are looking for or what you get from Jean Arthur.
But how often does that actually happen with any of our prime actresses from the period? It's not as common as you'd think from Hollywood's reputation of sexy chemistry. I guess Joan Crawford gets a lot of sexy chemistry roles.
Yeah, Jean Harlow.
Barbara Stanwyck? It's sometimes yes, sometimes no.
Yeah, I agree. And of course, a lot of the best films for women are just not about that.
Yeah.
They're not about...
Same with Katharine Hepburn. Sometimes yes, sometimes no.
Right. Certainly isn't necessary. It's probably more sidelined in Jean Arthur's career than with almost anybody else, which is interesting.
Well, I mean, okay, we were comparing her to Setsuko Hara.
Exactly.
And Setsuko Hara has a pretty important father-daughter romance movie.
Yeah, very much so, because this is pretty intense chemistry between these two, and they're kissing each other on the mouth a lot.
And staring into each other's eyes.
Yeah, it's just not a regular heterosexual coupling. It would be frowned upon if they went any further than they do. But go on a whole bunch of dates. They spend every moment together that they can for about a week.
Well, what is driving this? I mean, for both of them, it's making up for a relationship that they haven't had, that they've missed, and that they know also cannot continue into the future.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's what's driving this asexual romantic passion.
And it's interesting, too, because usually when you have this kind of thing, it's like a dual role, and the mother and daughter are played by the same person, or something like that, so that it's even more confusing and close to incestuous.
Right.
Here, she's just not at all like her mother, and he's totally obsessed with her anyway.
Right.
They talk about the mother.
This daughter that he never got to raise.
So yeah, it's supercharged emotion.
It's because he did not give her up voluntarily.
He's dragged off to the Huskow.
And she never questions him on this either. I guess she just understands what happens when she realizes he's still alive.
Yeah, I guess you gotta take it for granted that they must have talked about it off camera at some point.
Or she just understood. She just intuited it.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, she's smart. No words were necessary. Now, she makes it clear to him that he can't go testify because the papers are lying in wait and they're gonna snap his photo and it's gonna be the end because mom will see.
And she's married to a judge now. So it's a typical gangster male melodrama film where the gangster has to protect the respectable citizens. I mean, we saw a version of that in Roaring Twenties.
Yeah.
I mean, this is very much kind of a B-movie template for something like Roaring Twenties.
But he does not want to commit suicide the way Cagney winds up doing. You know, he definitely has other plans. He's going to go to Havana and live it up there outside of the New York City and the American press purview. The people that he's supposed to help out at this trial are not taking no for an answer. And Alan Jenkins keeps telling him, you can't decide not to do it.
Well, he knows what's going to happen.
No, I don't know. I think he's hoping he can get away, and he almost does.
Yeah, except that he decides to spend his last night at home with his daughter.
Yeah, I mean, he knows it's not a great idea, but it's her suggestion and he can't deny her, right?
Yeah, the movie has seemed so typical in its treatment of gender with Jean Arthur's character up until the point where she has that scene where she's serving him dinner and says, this is the last time I'm ever going to serve any man, which just seems to come out of the blue.
Yeah, well, she's been thinking a lot about this, and her boyfriend is seeming less and less satisfactory because he's making a lot of noises like a prospective husband and telling her to stay home. And
well, he's being jealous and possessive.
Yeah, exactly. And she's also getting it on the home front from her mom and especially from her stepdad, the judge, who's questioning her every move and asking her why she's coming in at 4 a.m. As John Oler pointed out, that's where she sasses him right back. The newspaper, she tells the newspaper, kill the story, it's over, he's not going to New York. Her boss, of course, does not just let it lie, and he puts Donald Cook on the story instead, and he trails her and him to a bar where they spend a whole afternoon, and his jealousy is just completely inflamed. And it doesn't get assuaged until the last part of the movie, the last scene, where he finally discovers that this is her dad that she's been cheating on him with. Jack Holt does give her the man's perspective on this. He's like, I would be jealous. You think I'm a paragon? No, I'd be very unhappy.
Well, he just doesn't want to be the cause of them breaking up.
That's true. That's true. He's just a really good absent dad.
Yeah, and he's been completely railroaded by society.
Yep.
By the people like the judge and his wife, his former wife. Actually, still his wife, legally.
Yeah, I mean, that's another problem, right? If it ever comes out, she's a bigamist.
Yeah, so this is the central irony that the movie has set up, that he's going to have to literally commit suicide because he's been screwed over by people like these people he is trying to protect.
Yeah, he still could have gotten away with it, except that that nasty mouthpiece from New York is working overtime to ensure that the trial goes the way he had planned it. He had envisioned it with Jack Holt giving this grandstand testimony, and he just doesn't want to fix up another alibi, or he can't. They don't really explain why they can't just pick someone else to give an alibi. I guess because they've made too many public statements about it, right? So to switch over now would seem very shifty. He actually does some detective work, aided and abetted by the spurned gun mall, who spills all the details about his right name and the fact that he spent 20 years in jail. So mouthpiece, the criminal lawyer, heads back to the prison town and finds out everything he needs to know about this and comes back ready to use it as a blackmail tool.
It's interesting that this defense attorney is basically the villain of the movie and not the gangsters. The other team of gangsters who you might think would be the ones in the plot who would come after him.
No, they never appear. They're in New York while the big gangster Kelly is in custody, so he can't do anything, but he sends his little legal monster after him. And they have the big confrontation when Jean Arthur is preparing the steak dinner, so he sends them off like people in a bedroom farce. Donald Cook shows up, everyone comes clean about what's been going on, then the attorney shows up. He reveals, either you make this testimony or I'm going to tell the world who you are. It's going to ruin your wife's life anyway. At that point, he has signed his death warrant, and Jack Holt says, I'm going to have to kill you now. He's only giving him two choices, and both of them are going to ruin his wife's life.
Right.
The only way out is to kill this guy before he tells anyone else what he knows. And that's what happens, although it happens off camera. We just hear the gunshot. Again, the emphasis is certainly not on the action. It's on what this is doing to Jean Arthur to know all of this.
Right.
So he kills him. Then he gathers up any incriminating evidence there might be around.
Well, evidence of his relationship to this woman.
Exactly. Destroys it and kills himself.
Yeah, and we don't even get the suicide shot on
camera. None of it. It's really all about Jean Arthur at that point. All the stuff she couldn't prevent. All this awful social contact.
And then we get the epilogue, which is the judge and his wife oblivious to this great sacrifice that has been made. The wife oblivious even to the fact that the man she loved was still alive, and under different circumstances they could have been together, and they're just passing judgment on this abstract gangster.
There's no way for them to have any empathy for him. Only Jean Arthur is left to carry the lessons forward. Sadly, she's going to be saddled with Donald Cook, because I guess she's going to marry that guy.
Hopefully he's been humbled by this experience. And hopefully she's still not going to wait on him.
Oh yeah, well, I hope that was a real declaration. That's it. Get your own stake.
So I said she doesn't quite have the voice yet. She is enunciating. I guess this is what she learned when she went back to the stage. She's enunciating way too much. Her English is way too proper. Doesn't quite have the gurgle. The gurgles are going to become more prominent when... Maybe I'm confusing her with Irene Dunne, though. But the almost sort of cartoonish qualities of her voice are definitely going to be more prominent when she starts doing the comedic roles, which makes sense. This over-enunciation problem, I'm wondering to myself, when does it go away? Is it Capra who starts really directing her properly with her performances? Or is she going to start figuring some of this stuff out for herself? Not that there's much time, because it's only 2 years from now that she's going to be paired with Capra.
That's true, but there are quite a few films in the interim, so we'll find out.
Yeah.
I didn't find that to be as much of a problem as maybe you did, but it's true. She's not quite full Jean Arthur yet, but everything, all the elements are there. So let's turn to the most precious thing in life.
So what is going on here? Why is Columbia putting an actress that they've just signed to a 5-year contract, an attractive actress who looks younger than her years, why is she spending this movie in old age makeup?
Well, it's a weeper, right?
Sure, that you can do a weeper with a woman who isn't made up to look 60.
Well, it's true, but this was a very popular style in the early 30s.
What other actress that we now think of as a major star ever spent a whole movie in the 30s made up to look really old?
Well, no, you're misrepresenting it, because we do see the real Jean Arthur unmade up at the beginning, right?
And I'm not misrepresenting it. That's a quarter of the movie.
Right, but everyone seeing the movie knows what she really looks like. So they're not leaving anyone with the impression that Jean Arthur is a broken down 60-year-old. This is very common. There's a lot of movies like this. So Big, Barbara Stanwyck spends almost that entire movie at mom age of an adult son, right? And at the risk of seeming, you know, she kind of gets upstaged by Betty Davis at the end of that movie, who's playing, you know, the modern young woman.
But does she have ugly old age makeup on?
Jean Arthur is going one or several notches ahead of most people, because you're right, mostly it's a kind of genteel old age that these weeper heroines settle into. Even when it's Irene Dunne in Backstreet, she's in her little Backstreet apartment.
Yeah, and that is, again, one quarter of the movie. But yeah, the genteel old age thing, that's what they do in Whirlpool with the mother's makeup.
Right, exactly.
But Jean Arthur presumably asked for this. Presumably this was her doing.
I'm not sure about that, but she went with it and she embraced it, and I'm really impressed. What
anyway,
did you think?
I'm going to continue to say this is an unusual choice for a studio.
It is.
Well, and for an actress.
Yeah, but I want to applaud her for it.
Especially an actress who was pretending to be younger than she was.
Bold.
And of course, it's one of those mother aging makeup things where her actual age can't be more than, say, 45.
Yeah,
and yet she's made up to look like she's 60. And I know part of that is because she's the idea is that she's worked so hard at this menial job all her life.
Yeah, well, that I think is really an important aspect of the film.
It's made up for it to look like she's worked so hard that she's gone through menopause prematurely or something.
Right. Well, look, this is a statement in itself that I don't think we should be sweeping under the rug.
Obviously, I'm leading with it.
Exactly.
Even if I'm making fun of it a little.
The point is made when she has her confrontation near the end of the film with Donald Cook, who just has a little graying at his temples, right?
Yes.
He looks pretty much the same. She is destroyed by the 20 years that have elapsed since they separated.
Physically, yes.
Oh yeah, well, mentally and emotionally, she's just as buoyant as ever, but it's taken its toll.
And she starts out the movie as a highly enunciating waitress, but as she works at this other job for the rest of her life, she takes on the Irish accent of
all the other biddies.
All the other biddies, yes. She fits in with the biddies better than she ever did with the high society family.
So it's a town and gown thing, right? So there's a big prestigious university, and the townies, they get trifled with and left behind, and she's one of them. She only meets Donald Cook because of the accident of working in a restaurant right next to the university, and she's not supposed to get involved with people of his class. The lines of demarcation are quite clear.
Of course, we can think back to that very interesting movie, Age of Consent.
Yes, absolutely.
Who directed that again?
So that was Le Cava.
It's a similar sort of situation.
And we start out again with quick courtship. The circumstances are different, but there's also reason for doubting the sincerity of our proposer in this one. And those reasons are borne out eventually. Certainly, Donald Cook seems sincere, or believes himself to be sincere when he proposes to Jean Arthur.
Do you know either of these two directors who are listed on Wikipedia?
Well, Lambert Hillier, I know, because he directed Dracula's Daughter.
Okay.
That's a famous movie.
And Robert Margolis?
No. Okay. I'm sure he did other things, and maybe I've seen them, but I don't know him.
He doesn't have a link.
Okay. Well, I don't think the film credited Margolis. I only remember seeing Lambert Hillier on screen, but
yeah,
maybe...
Well, someone knows something that we don't.
Right. So they get married pretty quickly. Graduation comes along, and we meet the evil parents of Donald Cook. Now, the mother, I don't know the actress's name, but she always plays this kind of society jerk. She is the evil mother in You Can't Take It With You.
Her name is Mary Ford.
The father is just irate, and he's upfront about it. He says, you're throwing your life away. This is idiotic. We're going to put a stop to this marriage. And Donald Cook says, well, you can't. You can't annul it. You just can't.
Yeah, the just can't is...
We've had sex, Dad. You can't.
Where it's clear that not only have they had sex, but she's pregnant.
There will be an issue. The mother, the real villain, knows the way to sabotage.
Well, it's interesting because you get these very dependent mother-son relationships, but one of them is destructive and one of them is healthy.
Right. So she says, no, no, let's invite them back into our home where we can undermine their happiness at our leisure, away from the prying eyes of society. And she has proven right. It's easy to do. You just drop a few little sarcastic comments here and there about how she's a low-class fool. Don't let her name her kid.
But also it may be the case that only in this one small way, like Stella Dallas, she isn't interested in fitting in.
No, she hates
them. She wants him to move away with her. That's what she wants.
Yeah.
And them to start their own lives.
Yeah.
That was a great line delivery, actually. I think opera is silly.
Yeah. And he just can't believe it. He's never heard anyone say such a thing. I've heard people say things against opera, but not that. She's determined not to fit in, and they're determined to exploit that to make sure that he gets a divorce or separation from her as soon as possible. And he's a weak-willed cipher, and he goes along with it. And the movie's meaning is clear. Rich young men cannot be left in the care of their families.
Well, he convinces her to give up the son based on the idea that all of these privileges will mean a better life for him.
Right. And she agrees at the time. And that's a really good scene. And actually, they both play that quite well. Not triumphing over her, right? It really is, this sucks. I do have to get rid of you. My mom was right all along, but I don't want to hurt you any more than I have to.
But I also want our son.
Well, yeah. He believes what he's saying, though, that, of course, if one side of the family is living in a mansion and the other side will be, doing who knows what, obviously the son has to stay in the bosom of wealth. And this convinces her, and she disappears. She says, I don't want any money.
Unlike other versions of this story that we've seen in movies, you know, where the mother decides to hang around where she can see the child grow up or see them when they're grown up or something, hang around nearby. It really isn't played for pathos. I mean, okay, yes, there are moments, like when she nearly gets fired, but we'll get to that. But yeah. Overall, the tone is not one of pathos.
That's characteristic of Jean Arthur. She's incredibly resilient for someone who is also so fragile. It's such a unique mixture.
Well, we kept talking about that again and again in the Margaret Sullivan series, trying to figure out the mysterious alchemy of what proportion of fragility and strength was in a particular performance.
Right. And with Jean Arthur, the strength is always mixed to the front, I think. But the fragility is there, and it just makes her strength seem even more impressive.
Well, I don't even know if it's fragility so much as just this impression of femininity, like I was saying, which is strange given the androgyny component.
Right, her desire to play magical young boys.
But those characters are androgynous too.
Well, yeah, Peter Pan was designed to be played by a woman.
Yeah, so maybe she wanted to be a certain kind of boy that was himself androgynous.
Right.
So really more of a kind of a pixie.
Very much. He's pixelated, a term that comes from Mr. Deed. It's all played very matter-of-factly, very calmly. However, you can't ignore the fact that she took a job at the university pretty much knowing he was going to go there eventually. Because it's a family tradition.
Yeah, so she's waited all of these years. So, as a son, we get another fun performance from Richard Cromwell.
Friend of the podcast.
Who I grew up hating because he plays such an asshole in what must be his most famous movie, Jezebel, with Bette Davis. He's just an annoying, snot-nosed brat.
Buck Cantrell's sidekick.
And a misogynist in that. But then I saw him in Hoopla over at Fox with Clara Bow playing the male ingenue to her slightly older seductress, and he was great in that, and he's very good in this too. Used very well. He has his most spark and most chemistry in the scenes with Jean Arthur.
Oh yeah, no, they're great together.
Calling her babe. So he's playing a bratty little snot whose privilege has put him in this position, and her whole role here is to secretly, by befriending him,
exert the maternal influence that she would have exerted if she had been able to stay around.
Right, and she has to be very canny about this because it's, you know, hard to undo all of these years of programming.
Yeah, and of course, a tragic aspect of that is that she learns that she made the wrong choice.
Right.
It confirms that, you know, this is not a psychopath, this is a good guy, ultimately, but she has to chisel that back out of what these rich jerks have made of him.
Well, his main problem actually turns out to be not that he's some kind of overbearing bully, but that he is weak.
Exactly.
But she is not.
She's not. He's not well liked by the other boys. And actually, we get a very interesting introduction to Richard Cromwell because we meet his roommate first, and Jean Arthur is getting to know him. And then they both see the name of the roommate and they have very different reactions to this. Of course, the guy is like, oh no, I know this guy. I went to prep school with him. He sucks. Jean Arthur is like, this is my long lost son. I can't believe it. It's happening. And of course, the movie never mentions that she had to have planned for this to happen.
Right.
I don't know if that's a strength or a detriment, but it's fascinating.
Well, I mean, would she know exactly what year he's going to show up? I guess she would have to if she's planned all this so carefully.
Yeah,
she'd have to be counting the hours and the minutes.
You'd think, yeah. I mean, she knows college. She knows when boys start at college. It's very much a planned thing, right?
So is she just surprised that it's happening at that exact moment? Who knows?
I think that's more just for the audience. And we see the way they interact right away. You know, he is very dismissive of her. She goes over and tries to explain what she can do and how the dorm works, and he just hands her a big wad of cash and asks for special treatment and walks out.
Yeah, but they do develop a rapport pretty quickly.
They do. And he doesn't act high hat with her. When he sees her examining his family photos, he doesn't say, get out of here, you gross old woman. He asks her, hey, do you approve? It's really good. They're dynamic. I like it a lot.
Yeah.
But he doesn't wind up doing all that well with the boys, ever.
Well, the best scene in the movie is the initiation scene. That was hilarious.
Yeah. You know, not everything in this movie makes sense from a 21st century perspective. Yes, she's trying to build character in him, and she just wants him to stop quitting things when they get hard. But frankly, I think his instincts were correct to back out of this fraternity nonsense. But that's really only because we're looking at it from our current perspective. In fact, the only reason you go to a university in 1934 is to join a fraternity so that you and the boys you meet there can go on putting over scam after scam on the American public for the rest of your lives.
Well, I'm sure it's still the same way in Ivy League schools.
Yeah, it's true. It's true.
You join a fraternity and then, yeah, this becomes your social networking.
Yeah, and you're
platform.
All bankers and lawyers. You just get each other on the phone and work your schemes and talk about the old days when you whipped each other with fish and stuff.
So really all she's trying to do, he actually stands out among his fellow Ivy Leaguers and prep school classmates as being different from them. So I don't really know where the movie's message goes with this, because she's actually trying to make him fit into that world better.
She is, yeah.
So she wants him to be a leader, and he's not anything like that now. She also has clearly got this she's kind of still in love with the idea of his father, if his father had managed to break away from the parental influence.
Of course, she's trying to rewrite history.
So when she talks to him about what a wonderful man his father was, she's not making that up. She really did see him that way initially, and that's why she wanted to marry him.
Again, this is not Stella Dallas, right? Because Stella Dallas never had any real strong feelings for Stephen Dallas. She was just interested in the world he came from. And then she realized, no, I don't like this world and I don't like Stephen.
So maybe the melodrama conflicts with any kind of social commentary, because we have to accept that all of these other boys are better versions of this guy than he is. But or maybe it's because he is the richest of them all and that he is supposed to be this leader figure and he can't live up to it.
Right, right. There's something there that's blocking him from doing that, right? And it's true, they are extra prominent at this university. We're told that an ancestor founded it, right, and built the towers, and so even more is expected of him. And plus there's this apparently strong line of football skills that have to be used, and that too, right, she has to work her magic behind the scenes to get him on the football team because he's muffed it there. He was already a renowned football star at the prep school, but because he's expected to try out, he doesn't want to do it.
Right.
And she has to negotiate between masculine egos, right? Because Ward Bond, once again, here he's the football coach, and he's like, well, I'm not crawling to this guy and asking him to join the team. He's supposed to try out. And on the other side, Cromwell is like, well, no, they should invite me. I should be specially asked to join the team because I'm so skilled.
And who knows? Maybe she played this role with his father. Who knows how long they were going out?
Well, that's true. We don't know. However it happened, it did work out well for the father on the football field. And here too, you know, he does, you know, she convinces Ward Bond that he's going to have to make the first move. And it all pays off because, yes, he is the best football player they have. If they're going to go anywhere, they need him, even though all the boys hate him.
Now, there is a big difference between the two movies in that he never finds out this is his mother. So the romance, although they do have a sort of kidding, cute, flirtatious mother-son rapport that's similar to things you see in other movies at this time, there's none of the passionate romance of Whirlpool because he can never know who she was and so he keeps her at a distance.
No, it's all sublimated into this new relationship. So along the way, we have met a few of the other biddies, but most prominently Jane Darwell, who is Jean Arthur's roommate. And Jane Darwell is a great actress in her own right. You know, she will become quite famous later on. She's Ma in The Grapes of Wrath, and also Granny in Devil and Daniel Webster. I mean, she's going to do a lot of quite powerful things in the future. And here she makes an impression as the cranky counterpart to Jean Arthur. But she's the one that has a growing daughter who's Anita Louise, who doesn't look very much like Jane Darwell. But Anita Louise is a friend of the podcast, wouldn't you say?
Sure. She's really odd looking. I've always been struck by how pretty and yet at the same time odd looking she is.
She's Warner Brothers' glamour star in the 30s, right? They tried to make a big deal of her. It didn't quite work out, but she gets some interesting roles throughout that time.
Her neck is too long.
She's too much of a graceful swan. We've seen her fairly recently in The Sisters.
I knew her primarily from Love Letters with Joseph Cotten and Jennifer Jones. I just always loved her. Like, she's playing the role of a shallow society woman, but she makes it so sympathetic.
Yeah, she's always sympathetic. She's quite interesting. You know, in The Sisters, we talked about that. That role is quite fascinating. It doesn't get a lot of play on the screen, but she's got to get across a lot of complex stuff there. She is involved with Alan Hale, that weird old man, as he often is, and does care about him, and it's just really...
Yeah, that's a good role, too.
It's a complicated role.
Now that I think of it. Yeah, again, she's playing a character who ought to be unlikable, but she's not.
No, exactly. She's the beautiful one in the family, and usually that's just treated as a shallow fool. But not in The Sisters. Not at all.
Now, here she's playing a likable character, and it's a little bit boring.
Yeah, well, this is very early in her career, right? She's playing a 15-year-old at the beginning. I don't think she's quite that young, but she's very young. This is before her Warner Brothers contract. So she is sort of being raised by these two mothers.
Yeah, I mean, speaking of queer relationships.
Yeah, exactly.
Because Jean Arthur's character obviously has not had sex since leaving
Donald Cook.
And we know, though, that Jack Holt's sex has not been very happy, so there's only a slight gender difference there.
That's right.
That is the gender difference. If you're never going to love again, you can have unhappy sex or no sex and a queer relationship with
Jane Darwell.
With Jane Darwell.
But yeah, it seems like a pretty happy little household.
Actually, that's kind of a parallel to the queer happy marriage that Jack Holt is in Whirlpool.
Yeah, that's right. One person's a little bit more upbeat and the other person is quite sour. They play cards. They've each played a role in raising, but I really feel like Jean Arthur has taken the lead role in molding Anita Louise's personality.
Sure, and now she's quickly trying to mold Richard Cromwell's so that she can have two creations of her own that she puts together.
But she doesn't mean to put them together, which I think is interesting too, right? Every step of the way, she's taken by surprise by events, it seems, but then works to get control of them.
Right. Well, we should talk about this major pathos scene for her, though, where she nearly gets fired.
Of course. So year one ends, and the way it works is you move to another dorm. When you're, so freshman, sophomore, junior, senior, they all have their own dorm areas, and the biddies are assigned. Is that really what people were always called at colleges?
I have no idea.
This is totally new to me, but they make it seem like that's just what it is. You get a different cleaning woman / mentor figure at every residence that you live in, every dorm. And it's all just, John Ray is the nasty janitor. This guy, he's an interesting actor. I don't know if he had some kind of contract at Columbia. One of his most famous roles, though, is as the guy that shows up at Mr. Deeds' house and tries to kill him. And then Deeds feeds him and rehabilitates him. I don't know if you remember that guy.
Yes, I didn't remember that this was that guy, but okay.
That's John Ray. He is the major domo. He barks orders at the biddies and sends them arbitrarily to different dorms. And then acts like it's a major crime if you try to switch for whatever reason.
Well, you're just not supposed to challenge his authority
at all. Exactly. It's all just totally arbitrary garbage.
Even though she's worked there for 7 years.
Glenn, she's done a great job.
Did she say that? 7 years?
Yeah. So we don't know what she was doing before that.
So I guess she went off somewhere and did something or other and then came back just as she approached the time when her son would be going there.
Yeah, it seems to me like she was trying to insinuate herself into campus life so she'd be ready when the son shows up. And she'd be a veteran and good at the job and wouldn't be fired in the midst of his schooling.
But that's what nearly happens here because she gets a little too emotional.
That's right.
And yet, you'd also think she would know about him being moved to a new dorm.
Well, she does, right? And that's why I guess she never thought before about, you know, what does it take to get assigned to the dorm of your choice? Because nobody would care normally.
She just blusters into this situation that she should have given forethought to, but she didn't.
And she's got all this money. Because she gets all these tips from her son, right? That she doesn't need for anything because she doesn't do anything except play cards with Jane Darwell. So she uses it to bribe John Ray, and that works out the first time. But then Richard Cromwell and his damn whims screws everything up because he's like, oh, this is next to a restaurant. Gross. I'm moving to another dorm. And when she tries to get a second transfer, that's when John Ray's like, you're making a laughingstock of the biddies. And yeah, my janitorial services.
It's all about the order of the university.
That's right. We cannot. And then he fires her. He's like, collect your shit. You're out. She can't believe this. But she thinks, clearly the dean is going to take pity on me. He's going to see that I'm a sad old scrub woman and reinstate me. But the dean is Samuel S. Hines, Pa Bailey from It's a Wonderful Life. And he's just like, no. He's the one that keeps saying, we have to run our university by laws and I can't interfere.
I can't override the janitor. And she explains the situation. He's like, that does not merit my intervention.
That's right. I just have to leave that little tin horn dictator in charge of custodial services. He leaves the room. He's done. He washes his hands of the whole thing. Go get a job somewhere else. The wife of the dean sees that there's something more going on here and takes the time to ask about it. And here we get the women working together.
Yeah, so this doesn't pass the Bechdel test, although although I think the Jane Darwell arguments do, written as a scene of women helping each other across class. Not something you always see in studio era movies.
It's important that she doesn't tell the actual truth about this boy that she wants to be near. She just says that she's taken on a mentor relationship with him, and she feels like she can help to complete his education and make him a product that the university will be proud of.
Yeah, and the dean's wife takes this seriously as something that these women could actually be doing.
Exactly. And of course, the dean would never hear of such a thing. Our boys are made in the classroom and on the football field. Not in the dorm rooms, talking to these old ladies. So a woman's perspective is valuable here. And
so yeah, I mean, in an Ivy League university at this time, there would be, you go to college and there's no more maternal influence at all, basically.
Except for these biddies. So the dean's wife says, don't worry, I'll talk to the dean after he's had his dinner. And we get the sense that if she raises enough of a fuss, he will just do whatever she says. That does merit his interfering in the affairs of the university. And Cromwell, through all of this, doesn't express all that much surprise that she does follow him to each dormitory.
Well, like, they have their weird little flirt, and obviously she's more dependent than he is, but he is not bothered by having her around.
No, he likes it. She is all important, you know? She gives him the football tips, even, that he needs to excel.
Yeah, they do their little dance on the field that he's made fun of for.
Yeah.
And one of the nice qualities of Chris, as played by Richard Cromwell, is that that actually doesn't really bother him.
No, because he hates these guys anyway. So he's impervious to that. It's really just his dad and his grandmother that are the problem.
So the idea here really is, I guess, if you're stuck with this ruling class, how do you make the potential leaders of it into good leaders?
Well, you have to get them away from their family. Right? Because everything in this movie is trending towards the result that Jean Arthur wanted for her marriage, which is cut ties, don't take money from these assholes, get your own job, and build a new dynasty, right? It's not a socialist film or anything. It's this liberal dream of everyone starts from scratch, see what they can do. It's a meritocracy.
Okay. Not from scratch, though, because this guy has gone to this college, so he's going to be able to get a decent job.
Well, of course, but they never really take that into account.
No, I think the movie does take that into account. The idea is that, like, she can't start from scratch. The movie doesn't think that she and her class of people, and particularly women, can start from scratch. And so I don't think it does think he's starting from scratch. But yeah, how can we get the best out of this class is the idea.
Use the money that got you to the Ivy League and then take what you learned there and start something new. Yeah, go to Chicago.
Don't just become some high society asshole, playboy.
Exactly. And those are laudable goals.
I mean, we saw something of that kind in Cafe Society, which was a Virginia Van Upp script.
Yeah.
That was very interesting. The same kind of idea. All right, we've got this class. How can we make the best and not the worst out of its issue?
Right.
Out of its progeny.
Yeah, and that's really the problem that this film concerns itself with. And the answer, clearly, is hook up with someone that knows what life is like on the other side of the tracks, and then leave town together and go somewhere else, start something new, start a new family, without these ridiculous traditions that are mesmerizing these guys into leading the worst, most useless kinds of lives possible. And Donald Cook is irredeemable, right? I mean, at the beginning, he just seems like he enters the marriage in good faith. Slowly but surely, the poison works its way into his system, and Jean Arthur doesn't help by playing into the family's hands at every turn.
Well, he has been turned into his mother, and this is also what she's hoping to accomplish with Richard Cromwell, but to very different effect.
That's right. It's a real tug of war here between the sides of the family. And it is satisfying that she gets her chance to confront Donald Cook again. And it starts out amicably, sort of. He asks after her and says he wanted to send her money and stuff like that. But it really comes down to an out-and-out war between them. And she does not back down. And he's afraid when she leaves because she says, I'm not going to let this happen. He's like, what are you going to do? And she doesn't do it the easy way, which is to reveal herself to be the mother. She really puts in the work to make him into the kind of man that she wants him to be, just with pure lecturing power and parables and use of the available materials at hand in terms of the situation.
There should sort of be a sequel where she has remained at this university and is continuing to mold future generations.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you could see it turning into a goodbye Mr. Chips kind of scenario, right? With someone who was not even a teacher.
So, with these first two films at Columbia, Columbia, what we see is a movie in which Jean Arthur's romance is an asexual romance with her father, and a movie in which she plays a character who is asexual for the majority of the movie. So that's pretty unique for an attractive young actress in Hollywood at any time.
Yeah, well, look, she's not looking to make her mark as just another ingenue. She wants to be different. Harry Cohn wants her to be different. All the stars are in alignment for something really special to emerge from this.
But it's blowing my mind that Cohn was permitting this to happen.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there had to be some kind of decision in making this movie that the idea of launching this star had to do with showing her abilities as a dramatic actress.
Highlighting her stubbornness, highlighting her as a person in position of knowledge, as we discussed, because that's right at the center of both of these films. She knows more than anyone else.
That's obviously something that interested Capra when he makes his films with her. I mean, his original films with her, Mr. Deeds and Mr. Smith.
Even You Can't Take It With You, that comes straight from Broadway, and he's using a script. They did rework it, and she is the one that knows more than everyone else in that film, too, I think.
Yeah, it's certainly not the case in Only Angels Have Wings.
Well, that's one other thing I guess we could talk about right at the end here. The Jean Arthur aficionados amongst us. I think George Toles is quite similar, isn't he?
Yeah, but I've also seen Jean Arthur crazy fans who love her in that role. Love it.
I'm going to give it an open mind, but one thing that I know I have complained about often, I know in my blogging days and probably on the podcast at some point, is when I feel like Jean Arthur has not been used properly by an auteur especially, I've gotten angry. So, a movie that everyone loves is The Whole Town's Talking, the John Ford film that did give her a big step up, and we'll be talking about it next time. I've always been quite ambivalent about that film because I don't think it quite gets it right. It's trying to be a Capra movie, and he's using her in his Capra movie before Capra used her, and I feel like it's got the balance wrong. She's not quite the kind of person that she would be in a Capra film, but again, I'm going to watch that with a much more open mind than I ever have before. We've been more open to Ford in general than I've ever been before in our series here.
Well, because we've been watching so many Ford movies that aren't Westerns.
Right. Only Angels Have Wings, I've been very resistant to that one my whole life. It just doesn't seem right that Hawks does this with Jean Arthur, but that one too, I'll try to give it the benefit of the doubt to see what's there, to see what it's doing for her.
Really have never heard another actress being discoursed about this way.
Well, that's why I mentioned it, because you've brought this up with me before. Why are you so possessive of Jean Arthur? Why are you so upset when someone uses her the way you don't want her to?
I hope I don't recall saying anything of that kind.
I thought it was very insightful.
I don't recall that. And I don't know why I would say that, because I did tell you that George Toles said the same thing and had a whole freak out about Only Angels Have Wings.
You put it in that context. You're like, why are you guys like this with Jean Arthur?
Back in the day. It just makes me wonder if there's some strange alchemy to Jean Arthur that if you use her wrong, it's just a disaster. Because I haven't really heard another actress being talked about. I mean, of course, you can see roles in which famous actresses are miscast, but it doesn't seem to be talked about the same way, where the whole concept of the character and performance just falls completely flat because somehow the strange magic has not been worked.
Yeah, and makes the fan angry. So we'll see. We'll see. I'm going to try to step outside of that for this. I'm going to try to be...
But yeah, like I said, I have also seen people who are passionate Jean Arthur fans on, say, Letterboxd or Twitter, who are very passionate about that movie.
Yeah, well, one way or another, people love that movie.
It's true.
So we'll see. We'll
see. Well, I don't love it. It's like every Hawks movie up to a certain point. Like most Howard Hawks movies, it's an extremely well-made piece of entertainment, but it's not working for me.
We'll see. Maybe we'll both have brand new reactions to it this time. That's coming up in a month or two, I guess. For now, though, let's turn our attention to Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. So on Friday and Saturday this week, we saw another two Kinuyo Tanaka films introduced by Andrea Picard. I think she gave us some interesting little tidbits in the introduction. Two very different films. We saw Forever a Woman, also known as The Eternal Breasts, and we saw The Wandering Princess,
which was a historical political epic.
Right. Well, so we went from a very intimate film about a woman going through every bad thing you can imagine at once. A marriage breaking up, uncertainty about her status as an artist, and cancer.
Yeah,
ultimately, terminal cancer.
And uncertainty about her status as a woman, as the title highlights.
Well, she has a mastectomy, and she feels like this has robbed her of the particular qualities of humanity that she associates with herself.
Yeah, but she expresses that in terms of being robbed of her gender.
Well, yeah, exactly. She can only think of herself in a gendered way, and her gender has been removed, according to her.
But, without spoiling the movie, she does get way beyond this.
Yes, well, maybe that does spoil it, but I think we need to say that...
Well, we don't... We're not saying how.
Not how. Not
or
how.
What the effect is.
Yes, ultimately, it is a kind of dark victory.
This movie was reminding me of some kind of strange cross between dark victory and My Left Foot.
Yeah, definitely.
As an unlikable, yet sympathetic, suffering artist narrative.
Yeah, I mean, I could see her making that puss in the corner speech in this one.
Absolutely. But it's much more sexual than My Left Foot.
Well, yes.
Which is not sexual at all. And this is pretty sexual.
It gets pretty intense.
That movie was unexpected. And, I mean, this is not unusual for a movie where a woman dies of cancer or anything else. Particularly cancer, though. But there was this was beyond the beyond. Okay, so let's talk about the conditions of movie going in Toronto right now. So the Cinematheque has reopened a little bit. It is now free if you have a membership to attend the screenings. The membership does cost quite a lot, and we paid it. And I imagine because there's not a lot going on in cinema going in general in the city, and at TIFF in particular, the screenings have been well attended.
Yeah, there are 5 theaters at the Lightbox, and the ones on the first floor are much bigger. The ones on the second floor, there's one that's really small, that little studio one, and then there's the one that the movies we go to see are mostly in, which is sort of the medium-sized one.
Right, and the screenings have been well attended by people of all ages, and there were people crying hysterically and, like, howling at the end of this movie.
I've never heard that in a movie, ever.
No. So that's interesting. I had my analytical hat on, so I was doing my usual thing where I did not feel like the movie was affecting me emotionally until the end, and then the tears start going.
Well, I think this is really interesting. Both movies that we saw this weekend definitely made me cry. My eyes were watering, but I don't know where the wailing comes from. That happen to me in a film.
And then in the bathroom, well, this is just, obviously someone was very powerfully affected by this movie. Maybe they had breast cancer and knew someone who died of it.
Right.
And then in the bathroom, I heard some young girls talking about how they were crying through the whole movie, so much so that they had to remove their masks because they were soaked. Yeah, so it didn't viscerally affect me the way it was a lot of the audience. The way that maybe the Cloud Cap star did the first time I saw it. But definitely it had interesting qualities.
I thought it was a great movie. I was viscerally affected by it. I just didn't make a lot of noise, but I cried. I mean, I think it's very upsetting.
I'll discuss the exact point at which I started crying when we do it again, if I remember by that time.
Yeah, in 2028.
I might cry at a different point in 2028. Anyway, definitely recommended. The Wandering Princess was a movie I had some trouble wrapping my head around, even though I have a slight familiarity with the period being covered because I watched Kobayashi's The Human Condition, a 9-hour epic that covers some of the same period of Japanese political history.
Yeah, I didn't get to see that.
Japanese-Chinese relations, so to speak.
Yeah, it was described as a historical epic, and I just didn't think about it again until we watched it, until we got there, and I found out, it's set in the past, but not in the long past. I was expecting medieval Japan, right? Like Sancho the Bailiff or something.
And I could tell from the little I was able to follow while watching it, I could tell that there was a sort of Juarez situation going on here, just because you and I have watched that as one of your favorite political movies and have discussed it.
I thought this was an amazing movie. Totally amazing. Loved it from beginning to end. And I meant to bring up Juarez as soon as I could, but you beat me to it.
Yeah, this is when we were talking over the content of the movie as we were walking home.
So it's a story about a woman raised in the Japanese aristocracy who is ordered basically to marry the brother of the emperor of Manchukuo, which was the puppet state that the Japanese were operating in northern China, you know, during the years leading up to World War II. The movie is about her attempt to make sense of this and make it a meaningful sacrifice on her part to do this.
Right.
And I think it really does an incredible job of showing us in good faith what someone in that position would go through and what they might think without ever making it seem like this was a good idea, right? I mean, this is, I think I saw one Letterboxd review where the person seemed to be thinking that it was exonerating Japan's activities in World War II. I don't know what movie they were watching. Absolutely not. It's ridiculous. This is a scathing self-critique. The introduction by Andrea Picard did give us some information there, right? So Forever a Woman is a black and white, beautifully shot, you know, chamber drama.
Yeah, and we also failed to mention the fact that, you know, the first two movies of hers that we discussed in one of these segments were, the screenplays were gifted to her by famous writer-directors. This one, these two, she co-wrote with a female screenwriter.
Exactly. Yeah, so here we're really seeing her.
Two different screenwriters, was it?
Yeah. So Forever a Woman was adapted from an autobiography by a Japanese poet who died of cancer in 1954, so the year before it came out. Then 5 years pass. I mean, she's still acting. It's not like, so she's doing all kinds of other things, but she continues to wish to direct, and she gets another chance in 1960, and a big chance. The studio decided they were going to let it rip, right, and finance a huge CinemaScope Technicolor extravaganza with a lot of expensive set pieces in it. And Andrea Picard said she used all the money. She took all their money.
And you can see it.
Yeah, and she wanted to make War and Peace, basically. And I really find it to be quite a success. I don't think that this movie has a huge reputation from what I gleaned just from Letterboxd. I think a lot of people think this is one of the weaker ones.
Huh.
I was really impressed.
Okay, well, in 2028, we'll have a big discussion about that, because like I said, I was hampered in my appreciation of the movie by just trying to keep up with understanding the situation that was going on. And I did say to you that I thought the human condition, I don't know if that was maybe targeted more to a global audience, because I felt that that made things very clear to me at every point. And here I was floundering, right? I could only get really the gist of what was happening.
Yeah, it does assume a lot of knowledge on the part of the audience about what historical events are going on and what they mean for Japan.
What you do see as a little auteur thing now emerging in these two movies that she co-wrote, you do see a queer relationship between two women develop as the movie goes on.
Yes, we'll talk about that. We'll talk about everything in great depth in 2028. I'm looking forward to seeing it again, and I do recommend, well, we've said this before several times, but if this retrospective comes to your town, do not miss it. It has been, you know, they're 4 for 4 so far. There's only 2 left, sadly.
Yeah, the skill here is great, and the auteur profile that's emerging is unique and interesting.
And I guess all that's left to say this week is,
what's next, Dave?
Next week, our special subject for June. It's the silent dryer sampler.
Oh, I'm looking forward to this. This was my choice.
So we'll be watching Michael from 1924 and Master of the House from 1925. We've never seen these movies. I don't really have any sense of what they're about at all.
Well, Master of the House, I believe that's the one that is an overtly feminist movie. First of all, somehow I didn't know that Dreyer had made more movies than I'd already seen. I thought his career started with Passion of Joan of Arc. So that was interesting when I'm on Wikipedia one day and I see, oh, there's all these other silent dryers.
He took so long between films in the sound era that, of course, he could be forgiven for thinking, well, he must have only made 2 movies in the 20s. That's what he did for the other decade. We're going to have a lot to say, I'm sure, about these. I'm looking forward to them, and hopefully you'll join us then.